Nikolai Vatutin commanded several Soviet fronts in the Second World War, taking part in the battles near Leningrad, Stalingrad, the Third Battle of Kharkov, Kursk, and the Korsun-Cherkassy pocket. In almost all of these battles, he faced off against Hitler's greatest general, Lord of the Universe, Erich von Manstein. Vatutin was then assassinated in 1944, but was Vatutin a good commander? Was he a bad commander? Was he as good or better than Manstein? And who assassinated him? Let's find out. Today's question comes from my patron Ernst, who said, "Hello Tick, very interesting channel you run, big respect, good luck in the future. I would ask a question about General Vatutin. What is your opinion about his actions at Kursk, and would you consider him as one of the best Soviet tank generals? And who do you think killed him?" Great questions. Let's start with a biography of Vatutin. When the Axis invaded the Soviet Union in June 1941, they annihilated the Soviet army at the border. By mid-July, they had conquered Latvia and had moved into Estonia. Well, in August, Sabinikov's Northwestern Front prepared to counterattack the German 16th Army. Sabinikov's chief of staff was Nikolai Vatutin, and he proposed an ambitious attack, which was rejected by Stalin and the Stavka. So, Vatutin instead launched a limited assault on the 12th of August, the Staraya Russa counterstroke, which failed. Vatutin's counterstroke was indeed a costly venture. The 11th, 27th and 34th armies lost 30% of their personnel and over 80% of their weapons between 10th of August and 1st of September. However, Vatutin's counterstroke delayed Army Group North's drive on Leningrad for another 10 days. Manstein's 56th Motorized Corps then arrived and outflanked Vatutin's forces. So Manstein scores 1 point and Vatutin 0. Vatutin's counterattack failed for numerous reasons, including bad weather and also poor command and control. The Germans had reacted quickly with both their ground forces and the Luftwaffe, which the Soviets couldn't counter due to their own air force being out for the count, and they had a lack of anti-aircraft guns. So was all this Vatutin's fault? Later, Vatutin's forces ended up encircling the Germans at Demyansk, but since Manstein wasn't there, that doesn't count. However, this is actually a good thing for Vatutin because the pocket was eventually relieved by the Germans, making Vatutin a failure here as well, so it wasn't a victory for him anyway. In late 1942, Vatutin ended up in charge of the Southwestern Front, where he smashed the Italian forces on the Don as part of Operation Little Saturn. This was part of, although certainly not the only reason why, Manstein was compelled to abandon his attempt to relieve Stalingrad. But it was definitely the reason why the Germans had to fall back along the entire southern front, leaving powerless to his fate. Yeah, they weren't directly in conflict with each other in this instance, but it still counts. Manstein won, Vatutin won.
Golikov overextended his Voronezh front after capturing Kharkov, going beyond his own supply lines with his depleted units, and then Soviet forces, including Vatutin's southwestern front, therefore marched straight into the trap set by Manstein, who launched a counterstroke in late February and March 1943. Vatutin's forces were devastated, with Group Popov getting surrounded and destroyed, and the 25th Tank Corps had to abandon its tanks and flee to get out of the encirclement. Golikov's front then got slammed shortly afterwards. Glantz concludes,
"Manstein's brilliant Donetsk campaign effectively halted the Soviet Stalingrad offensive in the south." Manstein 2, Vatutin 1. Vatutin ended up in command of the Voronezh front, defending the southern portion of the Kursk salient. His opponent was Army Group South, commanded by, you guessed it, Little Lord von Manstein. Manstein had 332,000 men, 1,508 tanks and assault guns, and 3,600 artillery pieces and rockets, versus Vatutin's 625,000 men, 466,000 combat troops, 1,706 tanks and self-propelled guns, and 8,700 artillery guns and rockets. Overall, Vatutin had two times as many men, more than twice as many guns, and slightly more tanks than Manstein. Worse, Konev's steppe military district was behind the lines with another 500,000 men and similar numbers of tanks and artillery guns as Vatutin, which is why Glantz concludes, "In a very real sense, therefore, it was physically impossible for Operation Citadel to ever create the penetration necessary for a true blitzkrieg exploitation."
So it was unfair to Manstein, who had had a major advantage in the early war, so I don't care, swings and roundabouts. Therefore, Manstein's forces attacked on the 5th of July 1943 and did get further than Model's forces did in the north. However, things had gone wrong right from the start.
By the end of 5th of July, Manstein's attack against the Voronezh front had not achieved anything like the success it needed for the Soviets to be psychologically damaged and their defences irretrievably dislocated. In some places, the attacking formations had barely breached the first Soviet line, and although the two main attacking corps had blown gaps in the defences, they remained short of the Soviet second line, were not joined up, and displayed vulnerable flanks. The Germans had significantly underestimated Vatutin's defences, and this immediately undermined Manstein's timetable.
At this point, Vatutin argued with the Stavka and got permission to dig his tanks into defensive positions ahead of the German advance, then attack the flanks of the German panzer forces. Given the German panzer's firepower advantage, Vatutin's tactic of putting his tanks in cover reduced the effectiveness of the German heavy tanks. At a cost.
Operations to blunt the German advance were proving extremely costly. Vatutin was certainly aware of this reality and was sensitive to the fact that the High Command's attritional strategy was not without cost to his finite resources. The famous Battle of Prokhorovka took place on the 12th of July, when Rotmistrov's 500 tanks charged across open terrain to engage the German tanks at close range, again to reduce the firepower advantage of the German panzers. This charge resulted in 400 of the 500 Soviet tanks being destroyed, having faced little more than 200 German tanks.
But while blame for this has sometimes been pinned on Rotmistrov, Vatutin also played his part in this. He failed to recognise that Manstein and Hott had planned to move 2nd SS Panzer Corps towards Prokhorovka, instead believing that they had shifted it to help protect the flank from the Soviet counterattacks. He therefore wrongly came to the conclusion that his counterattacks were working and decided to strike while the Germans were supposedly weaker than they actually were.
Having failed to penetrate Kursk through Abayan, clearly the Hitlerites have decided to shift the axis of their main blow further to the east along the rail line to Prokhorovka.
This was a false assumption, and so when he ordered Rotmistrov to attack, Rotmistrov had been given a false impression of the situation. Both Vatutin and Khrushchev then sent a string of messages to Rotmistrov urging him to hurry up and attack, and he had to choose tactics that could hopefully overcome the German panzer firepower advantage. He therefore decided to attack early, hoping to catch the German panzers in their assembly areas, and rush the enemy with his tanks without suffering many losses. Once his T-34s and T-70s had closed the distance, they could then engage the panzers at close range, what Vatutin himself described as tank hand-to-hand combat.
Rotmistrov's intention was to ensure that his heavyweight first echelon, having closed to within the crucial range of 500 metres, wherein their own 76mm guns would become effective, could then swamp the panzers, with the Tigers and Ferdinands deemed the priority targets. A mere 4 or 5 minutes should elapse from the moment the massed T-34s and T-70s gunned their engines and began their race towards the enemy positions, until they were amongst them, with success and survival turning on catching the Germans unprepared.
Rotmistrov's tanks charged forwards as planned, and the Germans, though shocked to see such a huge number of tanks rolling towards them, coolly turned their guns and blasted them at long range. With surprise lost, the tactics that Rotmistrov had chosen ended up playing into German hands. In the 5 minutes it took the Soviet tanks to reach the German lines, they were drowned by the hail of German shells. When the Soviet tanks rolled into close combat range, they were smashed, not just by the German panzers, but by Pak 40 anti-tank guns and Sturmgeschütz assault guns who were accompanying the German formations. Even the German infantry got involved.
"They were among us, on top of us, and between us. We fought man-to-man, jumping out of our foxholes to lob our magnetic hollow-charge grenades at the enemy tanks. My company alone had destroyed 15 tanks. The Soviet armoured phalanx had been halted."
Rodmistrov then sent in a second wave, but this also came undone. Clearly, his attack had failed to push the Germans back, and Stalin blamed him for this and sent Vasilevsky packing, leaving Vatutin where he was. Now obviously Rodmistrov is to be blamed for his tactics, but the point here is that Vatutin had his hand in this mistake too. So, as a result, Vatutin's plan to encircle the German spearhead at Kursk failed, and the problem I now have is trying to decide which commander won this battle. Obviously the Soviets won the battle overall, but Manstein had no chance of victory in the first place, so blaming him for losing it doesn't really make sense. Vatutin won the defensive battle, but lost many more tanks than the Germans thanks to that charge at Prokhorovka. Admittedly that was also Rodmistrov's fault, but Vatutin played his part in that, and was his superior, so takes ultimate responsibility, just like Montgomery gets the blame at Markigon for either Gavin or Browning messing up.
Therefore, this was a victorious loss for Manstein, and a lost victory for Vatutin. So I'm going to give both of them a half a point for this, bringing the score to Manstein 2.5 and Vatutin 1.5. I think that's fair.
Later in October 1943, Vatutin bent the rules of war by advancing his T-34s through swampy terrain, losing a bunch in the process. This allowed him to later exploit the bridgehead he had carved over the Dnieper, overwhelming the Germans and retaking Kiev. Manstein repeatedly tried to destroy the Kiev bridgehead, but failed to do so. Then on Christmas Day 1943, Vatutin used the bridgehead as a springboard to launch yet another attack, which was the beginning of the Soviet winter offensive. This time he crashed through the German lines, striking towards Zhytomyr and Vinnytsia, almost reaching his targets.
It was during this crisis that Manstein proposed to Hitler that he could counterattack in a similar way as he had done at Kharkov the year before. Hitler wasn't amused. At the Führer headquarters, the Manstein telegram unleashed a storm. In a rage, Hitler declared that Manstein was only trying to make himself look good by his pompous talk of counter-operations. He should give what he was doing its real name, running away.
Hitler just doesn't understand. The only way to win this war is to fall back to Berlin. We all know that the only way you can win is by retreating. Clearly, he's a madman. Hitler, that is. Anyway, Manstein counterattacked and did manage to destroy some of the spearheads, but couldn't break through Vatutin's right flank despite repeated attempts to do so.
To me, this is a clear win for Vatutin, so it's Manstein 2.5 and Vatutin 2.5, neck and neck. Vatutin's victory had also created a salient in the German line with roughly six divisions within it. This offered a good opportunity for another Soviet encirclement operation.
I'm going to create a video soon on the Kursun pocket to answer another patron's question, so I'll go into more detail there. If you haven't subscribed to the channel already, you might want to consider it. But as a brief overview, the Soviets deceived Manstein into believing that they were going to attack in another place. The Germans realized too late that they had been tricked, and both Konev's and Vatutin's forces cut through the German lines, met up with one another, and surrounded a bunch of German divisions inside what became known as the Korsun-Cherkassy pocket. Luckily for the Germans, General Stemmermann, in charge of the forces inside the pocket, had foreseen these events and had stockpiled supplies before the encirclement. When Manstein's relief attempt failed and the supplies ran out, Stemmermann destroyed his heavy weapons and ordered a breakout. Despite all odds, the first wave, actually a bayonet charge, caught the Soviets by surprise and broke through their lines. But then, disaster struck. Because of the initial success, everyone rushed forwards, and all sense of organisation and planning was thrown out the window. the second and third waves all piled into the first, and a glob of 40,000 men flowed towards friendly lines.
Group Stemmermann, an organized military formation just an hour ago, had fallen apart.
Stemmermann died in the chaos when a shell smashed into his car. You can find pictures of his corpse on Google Images, but I'm not going to show that here. Then, when the Germans reached a hill half a kilometer from friendly lines, they were hit by artillery and machine guns, sending them into a panic. Minutes later, Soviet tanks and cavalry charged, rolling over them and hacking down everything in their path. The Germans were routed. But they managed to slip around the Soviets at night and reach an icy river, with friendly lines being on the other side of the river. With artillery crashing down upon them and enemy tanks on their way, they dived into the river in a desperate attempt to get to safety.
Many drowned in their panic. Many were killed in the water, machine gunned or blown apart by tank and artillery shells. Too many got across to the other side, yet failed to gain a purchase on the steep, icy bank and fell back into the water. Hundreds drowned within a few meters of safety. Even modern weapons can't kill everyone, and the Germans did have the advantage of mass. The survivors still had to walk the few kilometers to Lysianka, headquarters of 3rd Panzer Corps, shivering in their wet uniforms and icy cold, and the snow. It was a grim way, a fitting end to their ordeal.
The Soviets claimed that nobody got out of the Kherson pocket, but that was a lie. Between 30 and 40,000 managed to get out, some by airlift.
Still, this was a clear victory for the Soviets, and since Vatutin's forces played a major role, it's only fair to give him another point. The final scores, therefore, are Manstein 2.5 and Vatutin 3.5, making Vatutin the overall winner and a better general than Manstein.
And that is how you annoy your audience. Now, silly games aside, the original question was, is Vatutin the best Soviet tank general? And my question to you is, how am I meant to decide that? Unless you have two generals facing the exact same circumstances with the exact same forces, you'll never be able to determine how good each one of them is. A general that's overwhelmed by sheer numbers and quality troops isn't necessarily a poor general. And a general who wins by sheer weight of numbers and has decent troops isn't necessarily a good general either. So Vatutin might have won out in the end, but that doesn't necessarily mean he was better than Manstein or the best Soviet tank general. Value is subjective, so if I say that Manstein was the best, someone will argue and say that Rommel was better. And how are we meant to determine that? Both of them faced different opponents, different terrain, different weather, had different troops and circumstances. There's no way to determine who was better. And why are we concerning ourselves with who was the best general anyway? What matters is what actually happened. This general faced this problem, made these decisions resulting in this outcome. But could he have made a different decision which could have led to a better outcome? That is the sort of thing we want to be asking, not whether so-and-so was a better general or not. I think Vatutin was a good general. I think he had his faults, just like every other human being, and I do think that he made mistakes at Kursk, even if he won overall. But was he the best of the Soviet generals? Well, you know, arguably you could say that Rokossovsky did a better job at Kursk. He employed similar tactics to Vatutin and didn't lose hundreds of tanks in a pointless counterattack. Model's attack basically ended on the 9th, well before Prokhorovka occurred on the 12th. They kept fighting just to support the south, but they knew that they had no chance of breaking through the lines. And Rokossovsky's performance during Operation Ring at Stalingrad was also very good. So why is he not the best? Probably because his performance at Dubno in 1941 let him down. But the point is that this is entirely subjective, and I don't think I can say who was the best Soviet tank general, or who was the best German general, or any other general from any other nation. And I know I did the scoring thing, but honestly, I can't say whether Vatutin was better than Manstein or the other way around. I only put the scoring system in there to annoy the Veribus and to keep you watching to know what the final score was, even though the rules were made up and the points don't matter. But realistically, they're both good generals, and they performed well in some cases and performed poorly in others. Manstein at Stalingrad. So, Now that I've annoyed the audience and avoided giving a solid answer on Vatutin, it's time to address the final question. Who killed him? The answer is the Ukrainian Insurgent Army, the UPA. Now, normally what I would do is give you some historical background information on who these guys were and what they were up to. However, the history of the UPA is super controversial at best and shrouded in an ocean of propaganda at worst. The sources I have in English on the subject are a complete joke. One is a blatant Soviet or Russian propaganda piece, and another is equally awash with Ukrainian propaganda. They both accuse each other of lying, and also are blatantly lying themselves. The third source I have is about the history of the Ukraine, and this seems more balanced, but it doesn't go into enough detail on the UPA, and it's difficult to tell if the author is correct because he's Ukrainian himself, I believe, and he says himself that he worked with other Ukrainian historians, which is therefore a bias I'm not sure I can overcome. To give some examples here, the pro-Soviet source says that the UPA was a semi-totalitarian organization which combined elements of extreme nationalism and fascism. Why? Because everything is fascist. Everything is fascist when you're part of the left. They don't even know what fascism is, but everything is fascist, guys. Guys, everything is fascist. How can you be semi-totalitarian? You either want total power or you don't. You can't want semi-total power. That doesn't make any sense. So straight away, you know that the author is talking complete nonsense. And I don't see any evidence of the UPA being national syndicalist with a philosophy of actualism. So in what way is it meant to be fascist? Is it because it's not Marxist-Stalinist and therefore must be fascist just because? And I would go so far as to say that if you're going around accusing anyone and everyone of being fascist when you have no clue what fascism actually is, then all you're doing is virtue signalling your ignorance and should be ignored. So, and there are more faults with this source, this is just the quickest I could pick apart for you guys, this pro-Soviet source is completely untrustworthy. Meanwhile, the pro-Ukrainian source says that the UPA ambushed Viktor Lutz, the leader of the SA. Really? What was Viktor Lutz, the leader of the SA, doing in the Ukraine? He's the leader of the SA, which is an internal organization within the Reich. He has no reason to go outside of Germany, let alone visit the Ukraine. In reality, it turns out that Viktor Lutz died in a car crash in Potsdam, which is west of Berlin. So you're telling me that the Ukrainian partisans managed to march to Berlin in 1943, and of all the possible targets they could have chosen, they decided to attack the leader of the SA, an organization which was largely irrelevant at this point anyway. Why? And why was there no mention of the UPA in Goebbels' diary entry about the funeral over Lutz? In fact, he says this: "The Führer was extremely outspoken and was not sparing in reproaches. The lesson he drew from Lutz's motor accident is that all cars of party members must cut speed down to 50 miles. I consider this a very sensible measure." So, no, Lutz wasn't killed by the UPA. He died in a car crash. The Ukrainian source is spreading propaganda. It took me 5 minutes to verify that Lutz wasn't killed by the Ukrainians. Yet, this source, written by 6 historians, supposedly, couldn't do this. So either I've got more common sense than 6 Ukrainian historians, or these guys are pumping out blatant propaganda. And again, there's more issues with this source, but this is just a quick point I could tackle for you to highlight the untrustworthiness of this source. Worse, because this topic basically isn't covered by non-Eastern European authors, I'm not in a position to give you an accurate account of who the UPA were or what they were up to. So, if you decide to read up about the Ukrainian insurgents, I would encourage you to approach that subject with extreme caution. Don't trust any of the sources on this subject coming from Eastern European authors, which is almost all of them at the moment. Therefore, for now, the only thing I can confirm is that Vatutin was killed by the UPA, and I can't give more context to it than that. Propaganda plays a large part in all our lives, whether you realise it or not. If you haven't seen my video on German Stalingrad propaganda, you really should, because there's lessons to take away from that which are relevant today. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.